Thanks for the kind invitation to come here to Cracow. It's my second visit here. I was here the last time 26 years ago, exactly, 1990, on Interrail. So from there you can also deduce approximately my age. So I work at the Åbo Academy University in Turku, Finland, and I'm a professor of psychology and law there. Although at the moment I'm working as a dean, so I'm doing administration. So that's why I like even more the opportunity to talk about my research, because I don't get those opportunities so much at this moment. So I've been doing work on a number of different topics. Besides interviews in suspected child sexual abuse cases, I've also been interested in how decisions are made in these cases by clinicians. I've also been interested in sex offending more generally, and specifically paedophilia, the etiology of paedophilia, and also the issue of assessing diagnostically sexual interest in children. And also I have a project going on regarding treatment of paedophilia as well. But today I'm going to talk about my favorite research project. And here the idea is to test whether it's possible to improve the quality of investigative interviews in suspected cases of child sexual abuse. And in order to, you know, do that kind of research, you need a problem, first of all. So I'm going to start off by outlining the problem a little bit. You know, what's the current quality of investigative interviews in suspected child sexual abuse cases, and what can be done to improve that quality? And then I'm going to talk about some empirical findings from my own attempt at solving this problem, which is to use serious gaming, to use an avatar-based interview simulation in order to improve the quality. So I'm going to give you some results from the experiments we've done with this method. So that's the basic outline. So current quality, effects of suggestive questions, you know, what they can result in, structured protocols as a solution, and then avatar simulations and their effectiveness. And finally, if there's time, a few words about decision-making processes. So, because obviously, as you know, if we gather information from the child, that's not the only type of information that is available. There might also be some other information in these cases. And how is that information integrated in a rational way? So some ideas about that as well. So first, let's have hands up. Just to know, it's going to be easier for me to calibrate my talk to you if I know how many of you know about the work of Michael E. Lamb. So put your hands up now. Okay, so not too many. So, you know, those who raised your hands, it's going to be a little bit more tedious for you guys. But I apologize for that. So if we want to talk about the quality of investigative interviews, we need some way of measuring that quality. And one part of measuring quality of investigative interviews in cases where there's a suspicion of child sexual abuse is to look at the questions that the interviewer has used. And there's a pretty standard way of classifying questions in these cases, and this work comes from Michael E. Lamb, and there have been some adaptations to it. But here you see questions that are recommended to be used in these kinds of interviews. And the reason for this recommendation is that there's lots of empirical research, lots of experiments that show that these kinds of questions result in more accurate and detailed narratives from the child. So we have facilitators, and there's an example there. What happened after that? I mean, these are just questions that that an interviewer can use to encourage the child to continue telling more. There are also invitations. Those can also be used. Those focus the attention, but without being suggestive. So tell me what you did yesterday afternoon. So that focuses the attention of the child to yesterday afternoon, which might be of interest, but there is no information transmitted to the child about, you know, what the psychologist thinks has happened. Then we have also directive questions that focus attention on details previously mentioned by the child. So in order to be able to use these kinds of questions without them being suggestive, you need the child to have mentioned a detail that you can focus on. So in this example, what game did you play with dad? So that would presuppose that the child has already mentioned that he or she has played a game with dad. So then it's, you know, it's okay for the psychologist to focus the attention on that detail. Otherwise, this question might be not recommended. And here you see some examples of not recommended question types. So here the research shows that if you use these kinds of questions, the quality of the details of the narrative from the child is lowered as a general rule. And it may be surprising for some of you who don't work with forensic interviews with children that option posing questions are in this group. So what does option posing mean? Basically, it's a question that can be answered with yes or no, or by choosing an alternative that the interviewer has presented in their question, okay? And these kinds of questions are not good. They, for younger children, they might be, they can be quite suggestive. Did he touch you? So that's not a good question if the child has not already talked about touching, okay? So questions cannot be analyzed without the context for them as well. Then there are specific suggestive questions. We all know about those. They suggest details that have not been mentioned by the child. But there are also unspecific suggestive question types, which do not suggest any specific detail, but are still not advisable. So the other children have told me about bad things that have happened to them. So as psychologists, we immediately can see that this is creating social pressure to tell about bad things that have happened. And that's not a good idea. You know, there are many examples of criminal investigations that have gone wrong from the use of unspecific suggestive question types. So that's kind of the background of how you measure quality based on question types. And then we also come to other indicators of quality. So what's the current quality of investigative interviews when child sexual abuse is suspected? And research has been done. I don't know about Polish research, but there's a lot of research that has been done. Finland, Sweden, Norway, Israel, the UK, Estonia, and so forth. Quite a few studies have been done where researchers have looked at actual investigative interviews with children, and they have classified the question types. And what have they found? They have, in each and every study, have they found that the quality is really, really, really bad. So the questions posed are not good. Lots of option posing, suggestive questions, not many open questions. So this is, for example, I mean, there are many of these studies, but I took this one because it's an immense effort that has been done in Norway with all that oil money they have. So they have invested heavily in trying to improve the quality of investigative interviews with children. So they've been training police officers by giving them theoretical lectures like this one here, and also some limited feedback on their interviews that they have conducted. Okay. And what have they found over a 10-year period? They have found, you know, that the patient is dead. Okay, it's a flat line all the time, isn't it? So if you look at these two figures in particular, so there on the upper left-hand corner, you can see open-ended questions. So those would be good questions to use. The types I just presented, facilitators and invitations and so forth. So over all these years here, from 1990 until 2010, you can see that those question types are not used almost at all. And there is no change, even though there's been heavy investment in giving training to police officers. So the training is not working. And the same goes also for suggestive questions. So there's no change in the proportion of suggestive questions. And this is, what I know, this is the biggest investment that has been made. So they've had a really intensive effort at improving the quality, and the result is exactly zero. So now it might be that Poland is a exception to this rule of bad quality. But based on the research that is there, there would have to be some exceptional explanation as well for a better quality than this one here. When I talk about, you know, when I present these kinds of results to my colleague psychologists in Finland, they always tell me, well, most of that research is done on American children, and they are talkative, they are social, Finnish children are quiet and they don't want to talk, and they just sit there and they don't say anything, and I have to do something in that situation. So the psychologists put the blame on the children. It's the children's fault. The children do not tell if you are not using really detailed directive questions, okay? And I think it might be the experience of some of you as well who have talked to children. But let's see, because, you know, not many times in a career you get an original idea, and the next slide, or the next two slides, are actually one of my original ideas. And you can see that it's a pretty pitiful one, but bear with me, nevertheless. I think it's an original one. So together with my PhD students, we looked at Finnish child sexual abuse interviews and at the dynamics there. And first of all, we found, as previously, that the quality overall is really bad. So you can see that over half of the questions are of not recommended types. So that's not a good idea. Over 50% are not recommended. But then I thought, well, is it true that the problem lies with children? So what happens if the child says something of relevance? If the child comes up with a detail about the event that is under investigation? So what's the next question that a psychologist poses? And I hope everybody here knows what the answer is. So if the child says, he touched me, what's your next question? No. What's that? Ah, yes. Yeah. Yeah. So not exactly perhaps in those terms, but I would say, you know, oh, please continue. Or you could also say, ah, he touched you. Please tell me more about it. Do you see? So, and this is something we can, you know, legal psychologists can adopt from the psychodynamic psychotherapists. Just reflect it back, okay? You don't need to introduce any own information in that situation. Where is fine, but it's a directive question, and you can still, you know, before using directives, you can still use invitations and facilitators. Yeah, good. So what about the Finnish psychologists? It's very heavy on psychodynamics in Finland. It used to be. So let's see how well they do. So what happens if the child says something relevant? Well, it should be exactly 100% facilitators and zero in all the other categories. But it's pretty much the same picture as in general. So the failure definitely does not 100% lie with the children. The psychologists don't know how to interview either. Because there's no justification in this situation for using anything other than a facilitator, just inviting the child to tell more. But the psychologists start asking about stuff that the child has not talked about. Okay, so this is an example of how that looks like for those of you who haven't seen these kinds of interviews in actual fact. So what does this look like in real life? This is from one of the cases where I have worked for the defense. A suspicion of child sexual abuse. So this is an example of a short transcript of an interview. The L is the child and H is the interviewer. So you can see that it's pretty void of invitations and facilitators, and something else is going on. And obviously, here we have this answer, me, we don't know what that means. It might mean that there has been sexual abuse, but it might also be the fact that the child is actually responding to the pressure put on the child in the previous questions. And this is from many years ago, but it's still like, it looks exactly like this. And all the research also shows that the problem is there and it's living on this problem. Some other examples, I mean, this is from one of my other studies about how language use looks like. This is a study where we looked at how psychologists talk to 3 to 8 year old children, but not only focusing on the question types used, but a little bit more widely looking at the types of questions. So for example, we defined a category of questions called compound questions, where there are many questions posed to the child simultaneously. And 6.1% of the questions asked by the psychologists were of this type. And this is an interview with an 8-year-old child. So if you look at this question, it's obviously not an easy one to answer to, even for an adult. I mean, what is exactly the question? Have you noticed that? I mean, what was the child supposed to notice here? I don't know. And neither can you. And it's 6.1%, so it's pretty frequent. Or unclear references. This means that the interviewer is talking about something, it or that, but after, you know, if you're talking with a 6-year-old boy, after all this interchange of questions and answers, what is it? What's it that was something bad? You get my point here? And this is 6%. Now we already have 12% of questions that are of this type. So unfortunately, the conclusion is that even though psychologists are trained in developmental psychology, they don't know how to talk to children if the task is to find out what has happened to this child. So now I'm not talking about clinical assessment per se. I'm talking about finding out what has maybe happened to the child. At least Finnish psychologists cannot. They are not happy when I tell them this. But now, you know, I don't know how it is over here. But let's look further in this topic. So probably you all know a lot about suggestibility research. I mean, what kinds of things can happen when you use suggestive questions. And here, in these previous studies, it was all about actual real material. And then you cannot know what's the truth. But if you run an experiment, then you can find out what can happen when you use those kinds of bad questions, suggestive questions. This is an example study. There have been many, 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 many experiments in this area. But let's have a look at this example study. So we had a clown coming into a child daycare center, and he conducted a game with the children. That's the game that was conducted. About 10 minutes, man offers a cookie from a jar and so forth. So it was a fun event for the children. And then 1 week later, we went back and interviewed these children. And either we interviewed them only using leading questions, okay, or adding to the leading questions also social pressure, referring to other children having talked about the event already. So those two kinds of manipulations, 1 week afterwards. And these are the results if we look at them. So we asked all the children these questions. And the correct response to all of these questions about the event is no. So all yes responses are incorrect responses. And in these red columns, you can see the proportion of incorrect responses to the different questions. And here, there was no social pressure put on the children, but here social pressure was put on the children. But do notice that both of these interviews were just one interview. So not several interviews, as sometimes happens in investigative situations. Only one interview, that only lasted a few minutes for each of these children. So you can see that 1 in 5 children answered yes to questions. For example, did he put anything in your mouth? 1 in 5 children answered yes to that question just within one interview. Even though the correct response is no, this guy who visited the daycare never put anything in these children's mouths. So I don't know if those percentages are you too high or low, but they are pretty worrying, I think, nevertheless. So this is what can happen. I mean, this is an example from one of these interviews, so you can see how this boy reacts. These red answers here are incorrect ones. Did he touch you somewhere? Yes, that's not true. First, it was the correct response, no. Think really carefully. Other kids have told that he did that. He changes his response to yes. Sorry, yes. So this is how it looks like in reality. We know that that did not happen. But that pressure, think carefully, other children have told me, it's enough to change his response. I don't know if you find it troubling, but I do. This is another one. All the stuff that is in red is untrue. And I'm showing you this example, so it's still just from one interview with this child. I'm showing you this example because sometimes, not sometimes, all the time when I read psychologists' statements about children's stories, when children have given testimony, the number of details, if it's a detailed story, that's taken as a sign of credibility. Yeah? It's all false. And this child puts it together within just minutes, within one interview. Nobody has suggested this stuff to him. It's just based on trying to please the interviewer and talking about something else. It's not exactly the event that has happened, but he's, you know, putting it together. So the number of details as such is not such an interesting indicator of if the child is telling the truth or not. So what's the solution? So that was just a brief overview, and you all know that there is, you know, an immense amount of research on both suggestibility and the quality of interviews. So what is the solution to this situation? So so far, only one good solution has been proposed. And that is from the research group of Michael E. Lamb. And his research group has shown that by using structured protocols, the quality of investigative interviews can be improved. And what are these structured protocols? I mean, you can the protocol in itself is called the NICHD protocol. NICHD. And if you Google NICHD protocol, you can go to a website where you can download this protocol in different languages. I'm unsure if Polish is there. Is it, Julia? You have. Okay, good. Yeah. Well, that's excellent. That's excellent. There are, I mean, different versions of the protocol, but it might be on that website, probably. Okay. So what's this protocol about? It structures the interaction between the interviewer and the child, and there are some, you know, kind of preliminary practice questions that are used that research shows, experiments shows, that make the quality better in itself. For example, I mean, I'm just giving one example, and this is making the ground rules of the interview clear to the child. So the psychologist explains, if you don't know the answer, you can say you don't know. If you don't remember the answer, you can say, I don't remember. Okay. If I make a mistake, you can correct me. So this is changing the power balance of the interview. And experimental research shows that if you do this to the child, what the child tells is of better quality. However, obviously, and this is the tricky part, the psychologist has to also accept these rules. So if you ask, you know, what happened yesterday in the afternoon, and the child says, I don't remember, so then you have to accept that response. If you don't accept that response, you've destroyed the rule by your own behavior. So it's not, it's a demanding issue to follow this. And then also in this protocol, there are guidelines for how to discuss about the abuse allegation, how to bring it up, and how to ask questions about it, non-suggestive questions about it. And what are the results? So just, you know, really briefly, if we look at the question types, you can see here, for example, that invitations that we talked about, if you compare interviews done without the protocol and interviews done with it, it's many times more invitations. And it's many less option posing questions. So the quality improves quite immensely. If we look at what the child then tells, so if we look at information elicited using good quality questions, we go from 19 to 51 details that are elicited with good quality questions, just using this structured protocol. And here, bad quality questions elicit less details. So the quality of the information probably has increased. The unlucky thing about this protocol is, and what they found out was that actually you can make people interview better with this protocol. They interview with it, you give them feedback after each interview, but once you stop giving the feedback, the quality goes bad again. So it's extremely labor extensive and expensive to use these protocols to improve the quality. Because you need to look at real interviews, it takes many hours to transcribe them and analyze all the questions and answers and give the feedback. So it's not a practical solution. I'm going to jump a few slides. So what we have, just to summarize, we have a situation where low quality interviews are there. We have a solution using LAMS structured protocols. Or there are others as well, cognitive interview for children and so forth. And combining them with feedback on the interview that the psychologist has done, or a police officer as well. And this feedback, for it to be effective, it has to be immediate, detailed, and continuous. So this is what is required from the feedback to the psychologist regarding the interview, for these effects to be sustained. And it's expensive, as I said. Another problem is that in real interviews, in real life situations, we do not know, as a rule, in over 90% of the cases, we do not know what has really happened. So we cannot give detailed feedback in terms of the outcome. So outcome here refers to what really has happened to the child. So if the psychologist finds out the truth, we cannot tell them that. If the psychologist finds out something else than the truth, using suggestive means, for example, we cannot tell that either. So you get my point here. In real life, it's not possible to know exactly what has happened. And this is a problem for giving feedback, because these feedback characteristics that are here, these come from basic cognitive psychological research about what's needed out of feedback for it to be effective. We need to get feedback on our actions, on our conclusions, for us to become more expert. A challenge for any kind of a clinical situation as well, as you may imagine. So what's the solution? The solution is to, you know, my proposal is to use serious gaming to improve the quality of the interviews. Because serious gaming allows us to give detailed feedback both on the questions that the psychologist has been using, that is feedback on the question types, but also on the outcome if the serious gaming is a believable situation. So what we created are avatars. These are the avatars in the system. So these are no real children. So we have had an artist creating them based on photos of real children. Then these avatars have been abused or not. So we've created for each of them a scenario of sexual abuse or of a suspicion of sexual abuse that is not true, okay? And we have predefined details that are in their memories. So we know their memory contents. There's a list of memories that they have, either of the abuse event or the non-abuse event. And these can be recovered by the interviewer by using different types of questions. How do these avatars know what to respond? We have research-based algorithms that direct their responding. So research, experimental research on children's memory and children's suggestibility has been, you know, we get probabilities from that research. For example, what's the probability if a question is repeated, the same question is repeated, what's the probability that the child changes the response? So that kind of a research result can be turned into an algorithm, and then if an interviewer asks, repeats a question to the avatar will respond in the same way, changing the response. It will become, I hope, a little bit more clearer in a moment. And this allows also for us to give outcome feedback. Because we know what has happened. If the psychologist or the police officer finds out something else, then we can give them that feedback. Or if they find out the truth, we can give them that feedback. So this is an example of an algorithm and how the avatar system works. So this is all taken from research. If there's an option posing question, you know, a question that can be responded to yes or no, and the detail is present in the avatar memory, 78% of the time the avatar says yes, which is a correct response, and 22% of the time no. If the detail is not present in the memory, I don't know or other responses here, yes or no. So you can see that yes response here and no response here is a creation of a false detail, as is a no response here. And these percentages are from experiments with children. And the avatar system is directed by a software that has 30 different algorithms contained in it. For example, another example is that if the psychologist or the interviewer is silent for more than 5 seconds, then the avatar reacts. You know, where's mom? Or can I go already? Just to put a little bit of pressure on the psychologist. That's another example. Yeah, so next I'm gonna show you a short, you know, clip from an interview with the first avatar version. It's in Italian, but there's a subtitle in English. So you can see that this is a psychology student. So she's trying to find out what has happened to the avatar. And you can see that I've chosen this clip because there's a creation of a false detail in this clip. Because the avatar first responds no to a question about what bad has happened, and that's the correct response. But when the interviewer repeats that question, what happens is that the response is changed in the end.
Mi fa fare cose che non voglio fare.
Quindi Sabrina ti ha fatto qualcosa di brutto?
Sì.
So that was it. So you saw there are two algorithms working. And this is the first version. It's much better now. But this is two algorithms working that has something bad happened with this Sabina. So first, the avatar two times says no, and that's the correct response. But the algorithm then calculates probabilities and changes that to yes in the end. And now, obviously, the psychologist thinks that she knows that something bad has happened with Sabina. And this is something that could happen in reality as well. As I saw in the, as I showed you in the example from the actual Finnish interview. So how does it work? How does the avatar know in the setup, you know, what to say? So the interviewer asks a question to the avatar. Then we have an operator, a PhD student, you know. They have to do this kind of stuff. So listens to the question and codes it. So the student codes it in terms of those question types that I presented in the beginning. And these automatically then launch the algorithm, and the algorithm decides which video clip is launched. So the operator inputs the coded question into the software, and the software with algorithms then launches a video clip, an appropriate video clip. In this case, you saw quite a few video clips that had the yes or the no response, but then also a video clip that contained some details about the case as well. And here's just to give you an idea what kinds of scenarios the interviewers get beforehand. So we have now 16 avatars, and each of them has a scenario like this that is given to the psychologist or the student who is going to do the interview. So they get background information based on which they are supposed to then interview the avatar. Okay? And here are the examples from one of the cases about what's in the memory of the avatar. So the red ones here are relevant details about the abuse. And the interviewer can arrive at these details by asking open questions. So then those will launch algorithms that then will result in these details coming up. And in this case, there is a detail here that reveals that Sara, this avatar, has actually been sexually abused. Okay. So what kind of feedback can we give them to the participants who take these interviews? We can give them feedback on the questions they used. So for each of the interviews they've conducted, in our experiments, we've given them feedback on the two closed questions and two open questions. So explaining what's good or bad about these questions and why they should or should not be used. So that's feedback on question types. Then we've given them outcome feedback. We've explained what actually did happen. So then they can notice if what they found out is the same or different from what really had happened to the avatar. And this is something that cannot be given in real life, the outcome feedback. So that's one of the innovations here that can be given. And after reading the scenario, the interviewers then interview the avatar, maximum 10 minutes in the current setup, and then they are given feedback or not, because we want to obviously see if the feedback works or not, and then they start again with a new avatar. That's the basic procedure for the experiments. In the first experiment, and that's been published, we compared just basically two groups, one with feedback and one without feedback. And the feedback here consisted both of feedback on the question types and of feedback on the conclusion. So what really outcome feedback on what really had happened. So those both in combination as compared to no feedback at all. And four interviews, and these were students. So each participant participated for 1 hour. So four times 10-minute interviews plus the feedback. And these results have been published, so I'm not going to go into the details there. I'm going to talk more about unpublished results. But basically they show that the interviewers use, after these four interviews, if they get feedback, they use much better question types. So they really learn from it and rapidly. So it goes like this. Without feedback, no change in quality. No change at all in quality. So let's have a look at one person from no feedback group first. This is a person who is from a no feedback group. And then we'll have a look at a person interviewing who is from a feedback group. So these are the last interviews, okay? So let's see how they are doing. First, a person who has now conducted already quite a few interviews, but without getting any feedback on how she's doing.
Have you always
done something naughty?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And what about your grandmother when she hits you? Have you done something naughty?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so they hit you when you have done something naughty.
So, I don't know, but I hope you noticed that that's not a good interview strategy, is it? They were really like these classical ones as well. When your grandmother hits you, and so forth and so forth. And we can laugh so far because it's a student who has never interviewed a child in reality. But we'll come back to that issue a little bit later. But yeah, then let's look at a person who has gotten feedback regarding question types and also outcome.
Tell me, who is Jessica?
She is my babysitter.
Okay. So tell me, when Jessica is not there, who is there at your house?
Sometimes Charles comes to my home when I am alone with Jessica.
Tell me, who is Charles? Okay. And tell me, what do you do with Charles?
Charles comes and then search for me and Jessica.
And what did you do after that?
When Charles gets me, I have to do what he wants.
So you get the idea. He's using open-ended questions that are of good quality. And also, this gives you an idea of the fact that the avatar is able to interact pretty believably. So that the avatar has, we've thought about what kind of video clips the avatar needs to have to make the communication flow in the case that that the interview is a good one. Those are movie tickets. We usually give two movie tickets to the participants of the experiment so that they want to come. Yeah. I don't know, I mean, they are visible. Perhaps that works better as positive reinforcement. Okay, so we in the first experiment, we found good results. So this is the second experiment. Here we separated the two different feedback types, feedback on the questions and feedback on the outcome. And just to remind you, in real life, interviewers cannot get feedback on the outcome, only on the question types that they use, which is a major problem. So, conclusion feedback informs of mistakes, doesn't give a direction for change. So if you hear that you've made a mistake and the child has told something else, then you know that you need to correct your behavior as an interviewer, but you don't know in which direction, okay? Whereas question type feedback informs of how to change, not of why to change. So if I tell you after you've interviewed, these and these questions are not good quality because research shows this and that. So I give you the direction, but it's not a really believable reason to change because, you know, what happens actually, you know, this is my opinion, it's not research based. But my analysis of the situation, I mean, why these problems persist all the time and psychologists and police officers don't get better, the reason is that by using suggestive questions and leading questions, they get to abuse details. Both true, but unfortunately also false. But these are so reinforcing for the psychologists and the police officers to have the child tell. So this is much stronger than anything a researcher can say about not to use these question types. So that's why the lack of outcome feedback is so central. But if you can give outcome feedback, then you are on a good way of changing stuff. Because then people notice that they have arrived at the wrong conclusion. And it's quite impressive in this setup that sometimes, you know, using, you know, the first example, this young lady who was interviewing, she was quite shocked after we showed her what really had happened to the avatar and why she found out this story. And some of the stories that people create by using leading questions are quite surprising. Satanistic, ritualistic abuse details, all that stuff that we know about from these famous famous miscarriages of justice. So what you really need is a combination. So that's pretty clear as a hypothesis. So we had four groups for all the different combinations of the two feedback types, and then four interviews per participant in all 192 interviews. And here you can see that these are closed questions, or bad question types. If you give them both types of feedback, it's much better than getting neither. Also, open questions increase similarly. Relevant details, you know, and those details are those memory contents that I showed before. So do you find out the truth about what has happened? So those increase if you give both types of feedback, and wrong details decrease if you give both types of feedback. So it's pretty consistent that the combination is better, but that's not a surprising finding based, you know, if you think about the theory, but it's interesting to be able to prove it within the avatar setup. That's obviously another issue. And conclusions. So how often did the students here, how often did they really find out what had happened? So you can see that if they got both types of feedback, in 45% of the cases, they understood what had happened to the avatar. Whereas if they didn't get both types of feedback, it was less than 15%, the level of correctly understanding what had happened. So the task is pretty difficult because, I mean, it's, and obviously the level here is not important because it depends on how difficult we make the scenarios. It's the relative differences which are important here. So just to summarize those results, why we need the outcome feedback as well and why it is a strength in the simulation setup. Then the next experiment, here we had 8 interviews, no feedback, feedback group, and then a group that received feedback, but then was also asked to reflect on their performance. But I'm not gonna talk about that as much because that manipulation did not work. But based on like cognitive science theory, reflecting on your performance should work, but we probably failed in some way making the reflection relevant. So we are going to go back to that issue later. Yeah, supposedly it should enhance performance. New avatars, better looking avatars than before. And again, we expected feedback to have a better result and result in better question types, less not recommended questions, and thereby more correct conclusions about what had happened. 59 participants, now 8 interviews per participant because we wanted to see if there is an upper limit for the performance, 472 interviews, and the same procedure, I'm not going to dwell on that. So here you see, here this is the main result, recommended questions. So on the x-axis you can see the interview number from first interview to the 8th interview, and the control group is blue. And their performance is pretty flat. So they use about 35% recommended questions. So that leaves 65% not recommended questions. And by the way, we give all groups before they start a theoretical explanation about what are good questions and what are bad questions. So it's just to show that theoretical lectures like this do not work in terms of changing interview quality. And these groups received feedback. Reflection, you can see it didn't add anything to the feedback effect. So they start at the same level, it's random allocation obviously, and pretty fast they are using quite a lot of good quality questions. And this results in finding out more correct details from the avatars, finding out what has happened to the avatars. It results in finding less wrong details, and the wrong details are created by the interviewer, him or herself. Okay. by using questions that the wrong details are usually based on a yes or no response from the avatar. Okay. And this results in more correct conclusions about what has happened. That's a logical, you know, result of the fact that they get the details from the avatar, then they know what has happened to the avatar as well. So that's basically it. And this is a figure that shows you a measure of clinical relevance in terms of reliable change. So it's a reliable change index, and you can see that quite a few in the feedback groups show reliable change, whereas control group does not show reliable change. This is the limit here. So it's an individual level statistics for understanding whether there has been improbable change in the behavior of the interviewer. I'm going to jump that one. So yesterday, I got the data file from my student, and he has just concluded the fourth experiment. So these are totally preliminary. And this was done in Italy. He's from Italy, so we did a study there. And here we again then had only two groups, feedback and no feedback, six interviews, and now we had clinical psychologists. So in the first three experiments, we had students. And when we sent one of these articles for publication, the feedback was that, well, I mean, who cares about students? Psychologists are obviously much better. So, you know, you need to show that the training works for psychologists who are actually working with children. So let's have a look. But these are done on the flight, on my flights from Finland to here yesterday evening. So, and here also we had then real children who had experienced the mock event. So first we trained with the avatar setup, and then these trained and untrained, you know, everybody was trained. They got feedback or didn't get feedback, and then they interviewed real children who had experienced a clown visit, as as is the custom in these studies. So 40 psychologists, six interviews, 320 interviews in total, 80 with real children. So what happens here? Recommended question types. So feedback increases recommended question types, and clinical psychologists. Now it's Italian. Beforehand it was, we've shown now that Norwegian psychologists cannot do this, and police officers, and Finnish ones cannot. And now here you can see also that Italians cannot. I'm not saying what's the implication, but you know it already what it means, probably what it probably means. Because these are trained professionals and they interview not very well. And actually, if you remember this chart from the student training just a few slides ago, we checked the means, and the mean here, because this first interview is without any feedback. Clinical psychologists who have worked with children are worse at interviewing the avatar, are worse at using recommended questions than totally students just from the lecture theater like here. And it's not significant. It's not statistically significant. It's just the mean difference. However, I have an idea. I mean, this is post fact explanation, but and probably you might also have an idea. But I think, you know, there is a danger in clinical work of, you know, creating your own theories, professional theories, and putting too much faith into them, and thereby you are more prone to confirmation bias because you think you know how these things work. And if you have a theory that's not correct, this is a problem. If you have for example, are using psychodynamic interpretations in CSA investigations, that's not a good idea. It will leave you astray as opposed to leading you in the right direction. This is the thing, like, when I'm speaking in Finland to clinicians, and I'm a clinical psychologist myself, I have a license to practice, I do not practice clinically because I think it's funnier to stay at the university and criticize from there, okay? Because I don't know if I would be good at interviewing, but you know, yeah. I've done my internship in a prison, and let's not go into that too much. But nevertheless, so so the thing is that I don't always dare to bring this up so clearly. But the thing is that experience in itself doesn't mean anything based on cognitive science research on expertise. Experience has to be coupled with feedback on your performance. And that feedback has to be unrelated to yourself. And then we can think about which areas of psychology and psychiatry are such where you get objective feedback on your performance. It's a requirement for expertise to develop. And unfortunately, and this was very clear when I worked for the police, it's exactly the same. Experienced police officers' opinions about what to do in a criminal investigation were very much respected, but actually for no reason. Because most of them hadn't gotten feedback enough times for expertise to develop. But we can return to this tonight at the conference dinner or later, if I dare to walk around after the talk. Yeah. So, but the same thing, the psychologist got more correct details out from the avatars and less wrong details. And those who had gotten feedback made more correct conclusions. Here, actually, zero in the no feedback group understood what had happened to the avatar. And this is just a preliminary thing that we also found that this avatar training effect generalized to the real interviews with the children. However, we have a real big problem that seems to be there in the interviews. Let's see what we can get out from it. And that is that these Italian children, they talked about many, many events. And this was 1 week after the clown visited the daycare center. But a majority, over 50%, talked about another event. So now we are in trouble. We have to redo the study and think about how can we direct their attention to the correct event to talk about. But this is also, you know, actually, this mimics real life when it comes to a CSA investigation, child sexual abuse investigation with a small child. One of the biggest challenges is to direct their attention to the correct event to talk about. But let's see what comes from there. So what I think I've shown to you guys is that with this kind of a setup, we can make interviewers better at interviewing just within 1 hour. And this is true for both students and psychologists. And we are running analysis on generalizability of these effects to real interviews. I had some preliminary results there about them actually being relevant for real interviews. And the next step, which we are working on, is to add automatic speech recognition so that we can get rid of the operator. Because now we need an operator there to analyze the question type, which is very labor intensive. But if we can adapt this to work with automatic speech recognition, so then we can train people via the internet, web-based training. So then, you know, the issue also of running booster sessions becomes much more, much easier. But it's just the beginning of the project, so these are, you know, kind of preliminary results there. Yeah, before I talk about, how are we doing time-wise? Yeah, 15 minutes left. So before I talk about some of the issues with decision-making, if we want to go there, I thought I would mention another one. Another exciting research result that I've been working on with my PhD students. I think this is the most important research result after, 26 years. And it is the fact that we run a meta-analysis of the effects of age of the child and the effects of the retention interval on how correct information is from children in experiments on their memories. So experiment, there have been a few hundred, we had all those, a few hundred studies where experiments have been done where children have experienced an event and then they've been interviewed at some retention interval after that event. So we had a look at the effect of the retention interval, because usually the studies only have one or two interval points. But we had enough in these 200 studies that we could look at the effect of the retention interval from 0 days until 50 days and had enough data to be able to understand how that affects children's ability to tell about an event. And then obviously we had also the children's ages, because we know what age those children are. And this hasn't been published yet, so we are writing it up at the moment. And the thing is that irrespective of the age of the child, from 4 years to 12 years, irrespective of that age, that didn't have an effect. But if you look at the interval effect, the effect of the retention interval from 0 days to 50 days, the proportion of correct responses to yes, no questions goes from about 70% to less than 40%, 35% about, from 0 to 50 days. And the child's age doesn't really have an effect on the proportion of correct responses. The effects are complex, but the effect of the retention interval is much stronger. And this has never been shown before. So I think this is pretty fascinating stuff. So I don't know if that was too technically said, but I'll try to repeat it. So what it means is that the effects of time running from 0 to 50 days is stronger than the effect of the child's age being between 4 to 12 years in terms of how much correct information they can tell about an event. And I think this has huge implications for how CSA investigations should be set up. I don't know how they are set up here, but for example, in Finland, it can take weeks before the child is interviewed if it's not a pressing, if it's not a current allegation. Obviously, if there is a suspicion of rape having happened today or yesterday or the last few days, then the investigation is done immediately. But if not, if there's no hurry, so to say, a lot of time can pass. And the implication of this result is that no amount of expertise from the psychologists or the police officers is going to change the disruptive effects of time passing. So it really means that these cases should be investigated immediately. And probably I'll hear during the breaks, you know, how it's set up in here in Poland. Any questions?
Dziękujemy panu profesorowi za świetny wykład. Czy zobaczę jakieś pytania do państwa? Proszę zorganizować podniesienie na ręki. Są dwa pytania.
Proszę bardzo. Marek też kiedyś pokładał. Chciałbym się spytać, jeżeli chodzi o Finlandię, czy w tych przesłuchaniach, wywiadach uczestniczy jakiś organ oprócz policji. W Polsce jest to, że sąd prowadzi ogólnie te czynności pod nadzorem sądu, jak jest w Finlandii.
I don't know if you guys hear me or if the translators need to hear me via the mic, but okay, what happens in Finland that it's always the police who investigates CSA allegations. So if a CSA allegation comes up, the police investigates, and the police decides if they want to use a specialized unit where psychologists work, so that's usually when the children are smaller, or if the police want to conduct the interview themselves. The police is in charge of criminal investigations in Finland. Finland is the only country besides Bulgaria who who has this system where the prosecutors are not in charge of criminal investigations until later. The police is present during the interview, and as is the defense lawyer, so behind a one-way screen. So interviews are tape recorded, and those tape recordings are the only evidence that is presented from the children in court. So the children do not, from children between 0 and 12, do not appear in court. Instead, the tape recording is presented in court. And the idea is that the defense lawyer, I mean, either they can ask the questions through the psychologist straight away, or they can have a look at the interview, and then there's another session where the child is put the questions from the defense lawyer. So this is the system. So the prosecutor only takes over once the preliminary investigation is conducted.
Ja może najpierw chciałabym powiedzieć tylko uwagę, która myślę Pana zainteresuje. To jest taka, że w Polsce, tak jak już tutaj wcześniej Pan zaznaczył, takie przesłuchania prowadzi sędzia. Psycholog jest obecny na przesłuchaniu i pełni on funkcję pomocniczą, więc bardzo często nawet doskonałe przygotowanie psychologa jest niweczone przez kompletny brak przygotowania sędziego, który ma pierwszeństwo w zadawaniu pytań. To się zdarza nagminnie w Polsce. Natomiast ja mam takie pytanie, czy wasze badania, wasze scenariusze zakładały taką wersję, kiedy dziecko celowo kłamie? Dziecko celowo opowiada historię nieprawdziwą, związaną właśnie z faktem, że było bądź nie było molestowane, ponieważ znajduje się pod silnym naciskiem którejś ze stron konfliktu, bo w Polsce bardzo często takie sytuacje są rozgrywane na bazie, takie zawiadomienia są rozgrywane na bazie konfliktu z rodziny. Czy wasze badania też takie sytuacje zakładały, czy są jakieś wnioski z tego, jak w takiej sytuacji dochodzić do prawdy, bo jest to moim zdaniem sytuacja o wiele trudniejsza niż dziecko po prostu opowiada sytuację, w której brało udział bądź nie.
Thanks, that's a great question. So in this, what happens in this setup is that the idea is to train, it can be also judges or prosecutors to use more open questions, but you're approaching another issue, but I want to clarify one thing first. When we talk about children lying, it's important to separate between conscious lying, intentional lying, and making mistakes, which is a different thing. So. Because if just to clarify this, that in many cases where, for example, that the...
Niekonkretnie chodzi o sytuację, kiedy dziecko zeznaje w sposób odmienny od prawdy, ponieważ oczekuje od niego tego rodzina, znajduje się pod naciskiem jednej ze strony konfliktu. Konkretnie o taką sytuację chodzi.
Sure.
Kiedy dziecko popełnia błędy, bo to jest oczywiście zupełnie inna historia.
So what I mean is that the reason, because children can either tell truthful details or details that are not truthful in the interview. And there are two main reasons for children to tell untruthful details, so to tell things that are not true. One of them is that they are lying on purpose themselves. So when they speak, they know what they are saying is not true. Okay, so this is intentional lying. The other situation is, for example, after a divorce, there's a custody battle, and one of the parents has suggested, you know, has discussed with the child a lot, and in that case, the child might be telling, coming up with details that are not truthful, you know, making mistakes, but those might be due to previous suggestion. So the child doesn't know that what he or she is saying is untrue. For example, we have this is a real example from, I don't remember, it's 4 or 5 year old child, and the child says that dad has done this and dad has touched me down there. Then the psychologist asks, how do you know that? My mom told me. because if you say to a 4 or 5 year old child, if you tell to a 4 or 5 year old child that, tell the truth, for a 4 or 5 year old child, that doesn't mean anything. What's the truth? The truth is what my mother tells me because I trust my mother. For example, this is just an example. So this approach doesn't really respond to those cases. But the thing is that in order to be able to identify untruthful stories, the more you get the child to tell in their own words, the better. Because then there is more that you can compare that story with, for example. So this is a starting point. So it's not, you know, it's not a bad thing to get the child to tell more about what has happened, and also that the psychologist or the police officer or the judge, by using correct interviewing techniques, they do not create more mistakes in the child's story. However, now I'm coming to, now I'm coming close to answering your actual question. So what's the response there? So what needs to be done is that when you have the scenario, you know, that, for example, that the mother brings the child on a Monday to the child care services and says that the father has abused the child during the weekend when there was a visitation, okay? So you need to think in terms of hypotheses. So you need to create the interviewer, which, or the investigator, it's different people in different countries. But you need to think in terms of hypotheses. What can explain this allegation? Is it so that the mother is lying straight away, with a straight face? The mother is lying, and there hasn't even been a discussion with the child. Or is it the case that the mother is not lying, but mistaken? And that mistake might arise from a discussion with the child that created wrongful details that confirmed the mother's suspicion about sexual abuse having taken place. And obviously, by the way, one of the least likely persons to sexually abuse a child is the biological father. But, you know, that's a different issue. We can talk about that later. So by formulating these hypotheses, you can actually start creating a strategy for how to test them during the interview. But what needs to be remembered is that the interview is not the only and not always the best method of testing these hypotheses. You also have to think about how likely these events are. Are they, you know, against or in accordance to the laws of nature? Are they confirmed by other witnesses and so forth and so forth? As you treat any other serious physical, you know, serious investigation of physical or sexual violence. But there is the tendency to somehow allocate these cases to the realm of psychology and psychiatry. And that's a mistake. I mean, you know, psychologists can help in the investigation of these cases in many ways. However, there has to be a proper understanding of how we can find out if something has happened 2 weeks ago, or if something has happened a month ago, and so forth. So this hypothesis formulation issue is a major thing. Because if you don't have that clearly in your mind, then you are bound to be the victim of these kinds of mistakes. And you're right. I mean, that's something we are going to include here. So because I showed you the scenario with Sara, for example, so then you can easily integrate hypothesis testing here as well, so that you can ask, so what could be the explanation for this suspicion other than sexual abuse? And this is like, I go around and supervise these units who do CSA investigations all the time. And one of the major things we discuss all the time is to, first of all, what kinds of hypotheses are relevant and what kind of hypotheses are not? And how you come to correct conclusion about, after you have gathered the material regarding the issue. I mean, one of the biggest things here in terms of the hypothesis is the issue of base rate. So how likely is this kind of an event? That's a major issue, which is many times missed by professionals from other areas other than psychology. For example, I mean, let's give you an example that there was a case in which I was involved where the child was telling that the abuse consisted of her father forcing her to sit on the floor on these kinds of plastic, these big kind of plastic nails that children used to, you know, there are these games where children put these nails into these holes, and supposedly the sexual abuse consisted of the father forcing her to sit on those nails. And also then he supposedly took pictures of those events. And this was a five-year-old girl about. So one of the things, when you start thinking about that kind of allegation, obviously one important thing, first to think of, is to think about is what's the base rate of this kind of sexual behavior. It's not helpful to say anything can happen. Obviously, anything can happen that's not against the laws of nature, but it's a different question how likely it is that something happens. And that kind of behavior is very, very unlikely, because we know what pedophiles want to do. We have lots of, you know, we have lots of self-reports from pedophiles where they tell what kinds of behaviors they engage in. And this is not one of those behaviors. So that doesn't mean that it cannot happen, but it means that the base rate is very low. So then you have to think about that's actually support, that supports alternative hypotheses about the case. For example, that this is a result of suggestive interviewing between the child and an adult, either the police officer or some other one before. Did I answer you a little bit at least? Yeah.
Panie profesorze, czy macie u siebie standardy zapobiegające w trudnej wiktymizacji dzieci ofiar wykorzystywania seksualnego, które by mogły być wykorzystane w Polsce?
Well, I don't understand. I don't understand the question completely. But and I'm not in that area. What I have done in my work is to look at how different types of child abuse, physical and sexual, result in re-victimization as a teenager, and those are pretty strong effects. Yes, please.
Chodziło mi na przykład standardy właśnie podczas wysłuchania dzieci. A te standardy, które zapobiegną trudnej wiktymizacji,
So you mean that the interview in itself might be a traumatizing experience? Yeah, that's outside my expertise. So just to clarify, so the starting point for me is the one that has been defined by the criminal justice system, that we need to find out if the children have been victimized or not. But what I can comment on that is that I think that it is in the interest of the child that the details that the child tells in the situation are truthful. So and this kind of research and these kinds of strategies help with that, so that we get a more truthful account of what has happened. However, for example, in Finland, the children are always told that they do not have to tell anything if the person accused is a member of their family, as also adult victims, alleged victims of violent crimes, have the right not to tell about, not to tell in those kinds of situations. One comment on that still is that it would be interesting, you know, sometimes when you see cases where the interviews have been conducted really badly, and there's reason to believe that the interview in itself has induced a false memory of sexual abuse. It would be interesting to look at that from a legal perspective as well. So who has then been guilty of sexually abusing the child? A little bit beside that. But you know, the straight answer is I don't know.
Okay. Jest jeszcze jedno pytanie. A lewą stronę proszę o wzięcie pod uwagę, że w sprawie było już trzy pytania, a państwo jeszcze nic.
Znaczy, panie profesorze, a propos tych fałszywych wywiadów, nie wiem, czy pan sobie zdaje sprawę z tego, że w Polsce, w polskim systemie prawnym jest zakaz zadawania pytań sugerujących, naprowadzających. One nie mogą stanowić dowodu po tej procedurze. To jest raz, dwa, choćby usary. Nie dość, że były pytania sugerujące, a także naprowadzające, dodatkowo wymuszające. Choćby, żeby pozostała jeszcze, prawda, dziecko chciało wyjść, pobawić się, jeszcze zostań, popytamy, w świadomości dziecka powstaje, że musi dopasować się albo do pytań, prawda, udzielić takie, jak chce, pytający pytania, wtedy się pobawi. o to mi chodzi, jak to pan widzi, jeżeli chodzi właśnie o Finlandię, we Włoszech nie ma, ale o Finlandię, jeżeli chodzi właśnie o zeznania, wywiady, które nie pojawiają się pytania naprowadzające, sugerujące, że tam też nie stanowi to dowodu. Dziękuję.
Well, in principle, these are prohibited, yes. But the practice doesn't reflect that. And one of the things, obviously, is that in order for us to understand if those kinds of questions have been used, we need to have a tape recording. So that's the starting point. Because what we know for sure is that you cannot trust people's descriptions of discussions that they have had. That's been researched extensively. And we know you cannot trust if somebody says, I didn't use leading questions. That's not a reliable response, even if they tried to be truthful. So that's one thing. The other thing is that the definition of a suggestive question or a question that is not good
differs between law and psychology in the sense that, as I showed you, option-posing questions where a yes-no response is required, those are totally fine from a legal perspective, and those might also be fine for adults. They might be fine for 15-year-old children, but they are not fine for 4 to 5-year-old children. So these are a little bit different areas of expertise in that sense, that the definitions are a little bit different.
Czy są jeszcze jakieś pytania? Nie, żebym wywierał na Państwa presję z tej strony. Jest jeszcze jedno pytanie z prawej strony. No dobrze, Państwo oporują tutaj.
Ja wszystkich Państwa przepraszam za moją dużą ilość pytań. Ja mam po prostu bardzo duże doświadczenie w prowadzeniu tego typu przesłuchań, dlatego też mnie dużo rzeczy interesuje. Co pan sądzi o okłamywaniu dzieci w czasie takich przesłuchań? I czy uważa pan, że dziecko powinno być poinformowane o tym, że jest nagrywane? Wiesz, u nas też się te przesłuchania nagrywa i często jest z tym problem, że osoba prowadząca przesłuchania, jak już mówiłam, w Polsce jest to sędzia, to nie informuje dziecko, że jest nagrywane. Czy pan uważa, że dziecko powinno być poinformowane, czy nie?
I think obviously for us.
Chodzi mi o to, czy ma to wpływ na potem dalsze zachowania dziecka, odpowiedzi dziecka, jak pan to widzi?
Obviously, the interview should be, obviously, the child should be informed. I think that's clear. It's unethical not to do that. Because they are, you know, talking about their parents, for example. So it's important for them to understand. And they have the same rights as adults under the, you know, in criminal investigations. And adults need to be informed about these things as well. So I think it's surprising if that happens. I don't know about research in terms of how it influences behavior. Obviously, one could expect that the interviewer interviews better if the interviewer knows that it's been recorded.
Dobrze. Ogromnie jeszcze raz dziękuję panu profesorowi za wykład.